Good evening, and welcome to our Good Friday service at Southside Bible Church. If you turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 27, we're going to look at two verses there and consider the tearing of the veil. If you're visiting with us this evening, we're glad you're here. And if you're a faithful Southsider, we're glad you're here as well. For coming together tonight to consider the cross, to remember the cross, to worship Christ for the cross. In Exodus 12, 2, God told Israel to begin their calendar with the Passover feast, marking that deliverance that he was about to accomplish. And he went to great lengths all through the Old Testament to remind them, do not forget the Passover. Do not forget that I delivered you out of slavery. This is who you are. Mark time from here moving forward. And as that deliverance of Israel out of Egypt pictures and points to our deliverance from sin, we come together tonight to worship because this is who we are. We are people of the cross. We are people who have been saved by what Jesus did on the cross. And because of that, we know God. And that will be the point of our text. We're forgiven because he died. We're sons and daughters because he was forsaken and bore the wrath of God. And so we consider the gravity of the cross tonight. And we do so with great thanksgiving. Great thanksgiving for who he is, what he's done. So great a love that he has expressed to us in his Son, accepting us in Christ. So let's pray before we read. Father, thank you for the cross of Christ, all that it means, all that it accomplished, all that it cost. Father, we come tonight together corporately on this Good Friday to say thank you and to worship you and to rejoice for this very holy moment when Christ was crucified. God, we pray that you would teach us from your word, you would encourage us, even in the sobriety of the death of Jesus. God, we know the rest of the story. And so we come asking you that you would exalt your Son in our hearts. For those that don't know Christ that are here with us, we pray that you would open their eyes to just what transpired on the cross and that you might give them faith to believe, to enter the kingdom. God, thank you for your great love for us. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this body and our time together. We pray that it would be glorifying to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Before we read Matthew 27, I did a little research this week, just thinking about Good Friday and what it means and where it comes from. And it was thought-provoking in many ways. Good Friday is also known as Great Friday, Black Friday, Easter Friday, in different sort of world religions. People all over the world this week and tonight and this weekend are considering the cross of Christ. And as I was reading some of the Good Friday practices from the Roman Catholic Church, from the Greek Orthodox Church, I was struck by the abundance of ritual, of things that men had created to do for God on Good Friday. Because men love their rituals, don't we? And this day is full of all kinds of traditions and rituals going on right now all over the world. Here's a few of them. Fasting, abstinence, penance, the reading of liturgies, ceremonies being performed, symbolic burial services of Jesus, chanting, wearing the liturgical color of red, performing various venerations. But the question I want to ask us tonight and have us consider is, what does God want us to do with the cross? How does he want us to remember it? And the only way that we can answer that question honestly is to open up the Bible. That's the only way that we're going to find any kind of truth, any kind of insight into this cross and how to remember it. And so tonight we're not going to approach the cross from man-made ritual. We're simply going to open up the Bible and we're going to read it. And we've been singing songs of praise to God for who he is and what he's done. And we are going to share in one ritual tonight, one ordinance, but God instituted it. He prescribed it, not man, the Lord's Supper, according to exactly how Jesus said to remember the cross. It's not that Christianity has no ceremony, it does. but they're from God and they're not ends in themselves. The Lord's Supper is a means to an end that we might remember together the cross of Christ in our heart by faith. Does that mean that we should reject all the other rituals going on tonight all over the world? I think it does. I think we should. Absolutely. They are unprescribed and they're unnecessary. Man has made a mess of the cross of Christ through his rituals. Rituals are so very dangerous because man-made rituals are not the friend of faith. It's the doorway to self-made religion because we create our traditions that God never asked for. And then we perform them and find hope in them and find some sort of assurance in doing them, all the while forsaking or losing the gospel as we exalt ourselves and what we've created when God has so clearly communicated to us in the Bible that he desires the heart. Christianity is a religion of the heart and knowing God. And Christ came to save us so that we could know him, not perform rituals. That's the point of our text tonight. That through the cross, God is knowable, not by ritual, but by faith. And if you're here tonight and you don't know Christ, the good news is you can know God tonight. As we unfold the scriptures and the promises and the hopes of what the Old Testament was waiting for and what Jesus accomplished at the cross, you can know God tonight. And if you do know Christ tonight, then we come together to just rejoice and worship and say thank you and express the fullness of our hearts because we do know God intimately, relationally. Matthew 27:50. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split. Matthew gives us a fascinating context leading up to the two verses we're going to consider tonight, 50 and 51. The crucifixion begins in verse 33, and the soldiers put Christ on the cross. Mark 15 tells us this is about 9 a.m., the third hour. They crucify him. They cast lots for his garments, and then they sit down in verse 36, and they watch and they wait. So the stage is set. And Jesus begins to die. And then from 38 to 44, the mocking begins. Verse 39, they're hurling abuse at him and wagging their heads. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross. Could there be a more mistaken and ironic appraisal of Christ on the cross? And the chief priests and the scribes, they mock him. He saved others, but he can't save himself. Even the two robbers on each side, dying with him, throw their 2 cents in, and they insult him with the same insults in verse 44, but Jesus doesn't respond to them. And then in verse 45, the crucifixion of Christ begins to take on a different feel. The setting begins to change. At high noon, when the sun should be blazing and bright, the earth goes dark, the land goes dark. And from the sixth hour to the ninth hour, from 12 p.m. to 3 p.m., there's darkness. And there's something ominous going on. Something is happening that the land would go dark. And then in verse 50, the text tells us that Jesus cries out with a loud voice. He yells out and he dies. And Matthew says in verse 51, behold, the veil was torn. Behold means look, see, consider this. Don't miss this. The veil of the temple was torn into from top to bottom. So just leaving that context and coming to those two events, Jesus dies and the veil is torn. This is what God would have us know at the moment Jesus dies in Matthew's gospel. So what is going on here? What does the death of Christ have to do with the interior decorations of the Old Covenant temple? And as we unfold this from Genesis back to Matthew 27, it has everything to do with what's just transpired. God at the pinnacle of salvation history, at the very moment of the accomplishment of the atoning work of Christ, points us to a piece of fabric hanging in a building. Everything changes here at the cross. This is the single greatest event in the history of the universe, the high point of the revelation of God, of the Son, of his plan. And so this veil must be very, very important. It is very, very instructive. And so tonight, let's explore the temple veil. Turn with me back to Genesis chapter 3. We've been having a rich time on Sunday mornings in Genesis, and so I won't set too much of the context, but in Genesis 1 and 2, God creates and he orders this magnificent universe that we live in. And he places man in the Garden of Eden, and there Adam possesses all that he needs. It's very good. God's provision, his protection, his purpose, it's a beautiful picture of abundance and safety and blessedness and peace there in the garden. With the greatest reality of the garden being this, God was there. And Adam and Eve knew him and interacted with him. Adam and Eve lived in the presence of God, the one by whom they were created and the one for whom they were created. And perhaps the greatest imagery of that relationship between God and man comes after they disobeyed him. Look in verse 8. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. After rejecting God's authority, after sinning against God, they hide from his presence, meaning they used to enjoy it. They knew God. They talked with God. They found their identity and their purpose. This was life to them to know God in the garden. But now they're hiding and they're running and they're ashamed and they're pointing fingers at each other. The death that God warned them about, they were now experiencing. And the culmination of God's judgment against them is to send them out of the garden, away from his presence. The violation was so great that God's just penalty was banishment. Look in verse 22. Then the Lord God said, "Behold, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil. And now he might stretch out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore, the Lord God sent him out from the Garden of Eden to cultivate the ground from which he was taken. So he drove the man out. And at the east of the Garden of Eden, he stationed the cherubim and the flaming sword, which turned every direction to guard the way to the tree of life. Because of one act of disobedience, man was banished from God's presence. God kicked them out, and it was just. He drove them out. But notice in that moment, he didn't banish them immediately to hell. He drove them out into his creation, but without him, which is incredibly merciful, which is incredibly hopeful. He drives man out as a fallen, sinful person, a sinful people, into the very story of redemption that would unfold over time. Meaning he drives them out to reveal over time the way back in. That's the hope of this judgment. And he would reveal this in history. And it would culminate at our text tonight. It would culminate at the cross. The reality is Adam and Eve are seemingly finished, but God is just getting started. He's just unfolding. How's he going to do this? Who's going to deliver man back into God's presence? Two things to consider regarding this banishment from the garden. The first is this: access to God was definitively cut off. At the east of the garden, God stationed the cherubim and the flaming sword turning every way to guard the way back to the tree of life. Meaning, you will not get back in here, Adam. You can't even sneak back in. And it doesn't blow my mind to think that maybe they looked for a way back in. That maybe they looked for another entrance, because out here it's broken. Out here it's hard. And it's difficult, and we don't have life. We don't have God. How do we get back in here? But there is no way back in. So who are these cherubim? Just briefly, cherubim are the most common heavenly creatures in the Old Testament. They're winged heavenly beings that guard the presence of God. And their appearance is a little bit mysterious, a little bit interesting. They appear throughout the Bible. They're not angels. They have multiple faces and wings, usually 4 feet. And they're guardians and custodians of the very presence of God. And the flaming sword here, it's only mentioned in this verse in the Bible. But probably that the fire has something to do with the presence of God, as he revealed himself in the Old Testament that way. The presence of God and the sword testifies to this. The certainty with which God drove man out. You're not coming back in. The battle lines are drawn. A sword, a flaming sword, is not an inviting sign that you're welcome to come back in here. This means war, and you're out, and the line is drawn. The second thing to consider regarding their banishment is that Adam and Eve lost everything that day, and so did we. 1 Corinthians 15:22 says, "For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all will be made alive." Romans 5 tells us the same thing. Adam's banishment is our banishment. Because in Adam we sinned. He represented us. Not only did we lose the presence of God that day, but we gained the wrath of God that day. The wrath of God now abides on those who do not know God, who are away from his presence. The punishment for their disobedience and our disobedience is so severe, so severe. Eternal separation from God, enduring his unending wrath. And that judgment still applies today. Tonight, if you're here with us and you do not know God, if your sins are not forgiven, that abiding wrath of God, it's on you. You live with that. That is God's disposition to those who have rejected him and sinned against him. And so we're glad you're here because there's hope. There's hope under that wrath. As we move out from this event into the story of redemption, the question is clearly on the table: how do we get back in? How does a man and a woman and an entire race of people bearing the image of God, made for God, how do they get back into the presence of God? And so God begins to unfold this plan, and he makes a covenant with Abraham. And he promises him an abundance of descendants and a promised land for those descendants to live in. But also a promise that blessing would come to the world through Abraham. And that promise begins to unfold in the creation of the nation of Israel. And God makes a covenant with them to be their God and for them to be his people. It's called the Old Covenant, the Mosaic Covenant. And in that covenant, God's presence would dwell with them. First in a mobile tent called the tabernacle, and then in the more permanent place of the temple. But he would dwell with them only from a distance. And only according to very precise laws. Laws that pertain to blood sacrifice and animal sacrifices. There had to be blood for them to even approach God. And so the tabernacle structure goes like this. The tabernacle was a tent. It had an outer courtyard surrounding a two-room inner area. And the outer room was called the holy place, and the inner room was called the holy of holies, the most holy place. And the presence of God would descend into the holy of holies on top of the Ark of the Covenant at the mercy seat. But only the high priest could enter the holy of holies to offer sacrifice, and only once a year. And there between those two rooms, between the holy place and the holy of holies, was a veil to separate the two rooms, which is what a veil does. A veil is a curtain. When you move into a new house, you put the curtains up first because you're drawing a line of privacy so people can't see into your world. Because those people outside are living in their world, you're living in your world, and you set up a veil, you set up a curtain. Write that in your notes. Put up a curtain when you move into a house first. I'll tell you the story because I know you've experienced it. I think it was early when we were in our house. I came downstairs in the morning, and either we didn't have curtains or they were open, and I was so full of joy, I broke out into dance. Have you ever done that? Nod your head. You've done that. I was just full of joy. I was dancing, to stop and look up at my neighbors on their porch looking down at me. You just move on. I should have had the veil pulled, the partition. God drew a line between him and Israel, between him and the priests. It wasn't just visual, it was spatial, and it was dangerous. Turn to Exodus chapter 26, 31. Exodus 26:31. The veil from the holy place to the most holy place was a division. It was a door, but it was definitely a separation. Exodus 26:31. You shall make a veil of blue and purple and scarlet material and fine twisted linen. It shall be made with cherubim, the work of a skillful workman. You shall hang it on four pillars of acacia overlaid with gold, their hooks also being of gold, on four sockets of silver. You shall hang up the veil under the clasps and shall bring in the ark of the testimony there within the veil. And the veil shall serve for you as a partition between the holy place and the holy of holies. The veil was beautifully and skillfully made. It had regal colors and fine linen, but it meant something. The same cherubim that guarded access to the Garden of Eden were woven into that curtain, meaning this: you still can't come in here. Access is still denied. Things are not right between you and God. These images were divine stop signs in the veil. God and man are not reconciled. Holiness is within the veil. Sinfulness is without. The king will not see you today because there's no peace yet. And inside that veil was the Ark of the Covenant, this ornate box to hold the Ten Commandments, the Word of God, and other items that were relevant to the covenant. But on top of the Ark was the mercy seat. It was God's throne, the very place where his presence would descend in that Holy of Holies. And at each end of the mercy seat was a cherub with its wings pointed upward to cover that mercy seat. Outside the Holy of Holies, the veil testified to the guarded presence of God. Inside the Holy of Holies, the cherubim spoke to the same reality. God is not accessible. God is off limits. Even on the Day of Atonement, once a year, when the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies, it was clear that this wasn't the restoration of God and man. Though the temple had all kinds of garden motifs and symbols on the inside, you probably thought this way too. I used to have a fascination with the high priest entering the most holy place. Like, that would be so incredible to go in there. Turn to Leviticus 16:2. I don't have that fascination anymore because of the severity, the precision, the danger. This was the most dangerous job on the planet, to go into the most holy place. Leviticus 16:2. The Lord said to Moses, "Tell your brother Aaron that he shall not enter at any time into the holy place inside the veil, because before the mercy seat, which is on the ark, or he will die. For I will appear in the cloud over the mercy seat." The approach, even for the high priest, once a year, was so controlled and so precise. If you want to enter into his presence, you have to go through the veil. And to do so was so very, very cautious and dangerous. And once you're inside, you're still not safe. Look down at verse 11. "Then Aaron shall offer the bull of the sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his household. And he shall slaughter the bull of the sin offering, which is for himself. He shall take a fire pan full of coals of fire from upon the altar before the Lord, and two handfuls of finely ground sweet incense, and bring it inside the veil. He shall put the incense on the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of incense may cover the mercy seat that is on the ark of the testimony. Otherwise, he will die." Even in the presence of God, the high priest is hiding from God. He's shielded from his presence. "Cover it up," God says, "or you're going to die." And the entire Old Covenant law and sacrificial system, it preached the holiness of God. It preached this separation. And it preached the sinfulness of man and the continued separation between God and man. And this is so clear in Hebrews 9. Turn to Hebrews 9:6 with me. Because the author explains the tabernacle system in these very terms. One through five are describing the Holy of Holies and the holy place, and how the tabernacle was set up. And then in verse 6, Hebrews 9:6. Now, when these things have been so prepared, the priests are continually entering the outer tabernacles, performing the divine worship. But into the second, only the high priest enters once a year, not without taking blood, which he offers for himself and for the sins of the people committed in ignorance. The Holy Spirit is signifying this, that the way into the holy place has not yet been disclosed while the outer tabernacle is still standing, which is a symbol for the present time. Accordingly, both gifts and sacrifices are offered, which cannot make the worshiper perfect in conscience, since they relate only to food and drink and various washings, regulations for the body imposed until a time of reformation. That is a phenomenal interpretation of the tabernacle and the access problem. As long as the outer tabernacle is standing, you can't access God. You can't come in. The very existence of the tabernacle and the temple structures mean that God and man are not yet friends. There's no peace. It's a functioning picture of separation and denied access until when? Verse 10 says, until a time of reformation. Until God would do something to change that. And when is that time? That time is at the cross of Christ in Matthew 27:50, if you'll turn back there. Matthew 27:50, when Jesus dies, is the time of reformation. I want to give us five brief gospel truths that the torn veil preaches to us. And I'm sure there's more, but I just want to give us these five regarding the veil. Number one, God did this. The text doesn't say who tore the veil. And so was it a chance event? Was it the result of the earthquake or some random thing that happened in the temple? There's no way. It's there because God tore the veil. This was a divine act of God's mercy resulting from God's justice being satisfied. You can only tear the veil if there is access to the presence of God. And you only have access to God if sin is paid for, and that's what Jesus did. It's an expression of God's justice being satisfied. Only God could achieve access to God. The veil was torn from top to bottom. Salvation comes from God down to man. Salvation never comes from man bringing something up to God. One man said this, God was the master of ceremonies at the cross. God did this. God put his son on the cross. And God punished him for sin. And God tore the veil. Isaiah 53:10, but the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief, if he would render himself as a guilt offering. And so God poured out his wrath on his son. And when it was finished, he tore the veil in victory. But it was his victory. This wasn't man's accomplishment. He delivered us from sin. The entire Bible testifies to this. Man can never gain access to God on his own terms, on his own righteousness. Isaiah 59:2. But your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. But human beings are creative little creatures. And we develop ways to pacify our guilt and this separation from God. And so the world creates things, and we firmly believe that either God is a myth, or that if there is a God, somehow he's attainable. That he would never demand what he says he demands. And what he says he demands is absolute righteousness, perfect holiness. And who can do that? And so it seems even unreasonable for him to ask. We firmly believe that if there is a veil, somehow, some way, I'll make my way through it. I'll figure it out. When nothing could be further from the truth. And so we must lower God. We must make his standard more attainable. And we must elevate ourselves and make our sins more excusable. I was talking with a lady in a park last summer about the gospel. We were just watching kids play, and we began to talk, and we began to talk about the gospel, and she was an absolute blank slate. She had never heard anything of the Bible. She knew nothing of the gospel. And so as we began to speak about sin, I used myself as the example. And I told her about my unrighteousness and my rebellion before God and my separation and my inability to do what God requires. And her response to me was, it was surprising. She disagreed with me and she began to defend my righteousness. She said, no, that's not true. I know that you're a good man. I know that you're a good father. I know that you're good to your kids and that you're a good man. But what was she really defending? Her own righteousness. Because if I'm not okay, she's not okay. And so she had to make me okay. It was the strangest thing. Just go talk to my wife. Tell my wife those things that you're telling me. I didn't say that to her, but I had to fight her. No, that is not who I am. That is not what the Bible says. Because she had to find hope that somehow she was okay with God. You and I are not okay with God. And God is telling us that we do not have access to him because of our sin. And the veil only confirms this. The veil defines that separation. And as long as you believe that you are okay, you will never know God. You will never be saved. You can never be saved because you can never be forgiven because you fundamentally don't believe that you need to be forgiven. But praise God that he tore the veil and he made a way for sinners to enter. 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ also died for sins once for all, the just for the unjust, so that he might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. The second gospel truth that we get from the torn veil is this: God did this violently. Look at the text. The land goes dark. There's an earthquake. Rocks are splitting. Jesus is crying out. He screams out before he dies a brutal death. Why is this? Why does it have to be that way? Why not a sunny day and birds chirping and happy people and a delightful, simple little cross event? Couldn't the veil be nicely cut with ceremonial scissors, like the opening of a park? Doesn't that fit better with our Easter weekend? Think of this weekend, pastels and bonnets and bunnies and soft and delightful things. So why does the cross have to be this bloody, horrific, terrifying scene of brutality and darkness and gloom? R.C. Sproul says this: it is the cross that reveals the most violent and mysterious outpouring of the wrath of God that we find anywhere in Scripture. Meaning this: God does not go quietly. To accomplish redemption, someone has to die. The blood of the perfect Son of God must be spilt. Justice must be satisfied because the soul that sins must die. There are many interpretations of the setting there at the cross. And they're good. They're rich. The darkness and the earthquake and the rocks splitting open. But this one sums all of them up for me. They all testify to the fact that God was there and he was angry. He was judging our sin on his Son. And that judgment was hell itself. And the surrounding signs are not happy, quiet, peaceful signs. He is punishing sin on his Son. And the greatest violence of the cross was the crushing of the Son for the sins of his people. And we can't even see that part. And so sin is no laughing matter. If you're here tonight and you take your sin lightly and you walk in immorality and you do whatever you please in rebellion to God and you care nothing for what he said and who he is, please reconsider, because sin is no laughing matter to God. And the cross brutally testifies to that. Submit yourself to the picture that Matthew 27 gives us. The violence of the cross. If this is what it takes to rip the veil and to gain access to God, then I am not okay in my self-righteousness and my self-made religion. And there is no other way. And so I must humbly submit to God's deliverance and never again believe that I could somehow gain access on my own. Tozer says the cross is rough and it's deadly, but it's effective. It was violent, but it worked. The third truth regarding the veil, the gospel truth, is that God did this completely. Notice that the veil is torn from top to bottom, all the way down. This was not a partial access. This was not giving us a peek into the Holy of Holies. This was ripping it open to the very presence of God. When sin is taken out of the way, you and I have absolute, full, unrestrained access to the God of the universe. Because that which kept us from God has been completely taken out of the way via the cross. We sang it tonight, full atonement. Can it be? Hallelujah, what a Savior. A torn veil means it can be. And it is. It is through Christ. Every last sin was paid for so that I don't need to add anything to the cross. It was perfect and full and free. The veil was completely torn top to bottom. The fourth gospel truth that the veil teaches us is this. God did this finally and irreparably. The torn veil will never be sewn back up. There's a finality to the cross. It is both full and it is finished. And the Bible tells us that Christ died for sin once. And the torn veil was the elimination of the old covenant sacrificial system because that which it pointed to had come. The time of Reformation was now. And the temple would be destroyed some 40 years later. But think about Hebrews 9 again. It's so instructive. As long as the outer tabernacle is still standing, the Holy Spirit is testifying to separation. But now that the veil is torn, the Holy Spirit is testifying to precisely the opposite for us. The veil screams access to us and relationship through the veil into the very Holy of Holies that you and I can know God. And Jesus said on the cross, "It is finished." The tabernacle and the temple have yielded their place in redemptive history to the gospel because Christ has come and we now know God forever, permanently. Hebrews 10:14. For by one offering he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified, those who are set apart by faith. The temple was functioning that very afternoon. Priests were making sacrifices in the temple. People were there when the veil was torn. Can you imagine the confusion when it rips? What do you do as a priest functioning in the holy place, not going into the most holy place, and all of a sudden the veil rips from top to bottom? My only thought is you just run screaming out of the temple. What has just happened? Because the dangerous presence of God is in there. He might break out against you. But then at some point, in order to continue old covenant sacrifice, to perpetuate Judaism, somebody had to go back in and sew up the curtain. That is redemptive reversal. That makes no sense according to the finality of the cross. And so the gospel is telling us to run, but not run out the door of the temple. It's telling us to run to Christ that we might know the God who dwelled in the Holy of Holies. Hebrews 9:11. But when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things to come, he entered to the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this creation, and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood. He entered the holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. It's the opposite of the marriage covenant. When it comes to the veil, what God has torn apart, let no man join this together. Keep them separate. Fifthly and finally, God did this for you. God did this for us. The cross is so weighty, it's so big, and yet it's so personal. It's so intimate. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. The reality for every person sitting here is that you must know God. You must. It's unthinkable to not know the God who made you, the God who owns you. The value of your soul is too great. Your eternity hangs in the balance. And if you are to know God, you must enter through the veil to get to God. Turn to Hebrews 10:19. It's such a wonderful conclusion to the story of redemption and to the story of the veil. Hebrews 10:19. Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he inaugurated for us through the veil, that is his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. The imagery is so wonderful. I'm outside the presence of God. I'm under his wrath. I can't get past the veil. It's guarded. And it's guarded by the cherubim and a flaming sword and my sin and my guilt. It's so real. And if I go into his presence, the Bible tells me I die. And I'm asking the question, who can save me? And there at the cross, Jesus dies and the veil is torn and access is granted. And Hebrews 10 says that new way was through the veil. It was through Christ. His body was torn. Christ was broken for me. The violence of God's wrath was on him so that I could have access. And he drank that full cup of that wrath to bring me to God, to bring you to God. That which declared my separation from God becomes the very point of access to God. That's a blessed irony to it all. And herein lies the gospel. If you don't know God tonight, enter through the veil. The veil that was torn. Believe in Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And the Bible says you will be saved. You will know God because everything that stands between you and God will be removed. And you will be forgiven. On the other side of the veil is life itself. On the other side of the veil is God. Eternal life, forgiven life. A life set free to love God and to love others for the glory of God. All because the veil was torn. Tozer says, the cross stands high above the opinions of men. And to that cross, all opinions must come at last for judgment. Enter through the veil before you die. Enter tonight. Enter by faith. Christians, for us tonight, if you are a believer in Christ, may the violence of the cross bring you peace. Stop living like it's unfinished. The Bible is telling us over and over again, by faith we know God. Stop doubting and rest in that confident access that we have to him. Turn to Ephesians 2. And we'll finish there. Ephesians 2:17. Ephesians 2:17. And he came and preached peace to you who are far away and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have our access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints, and are of God's household, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together, is growing into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. That's phenomenal. We are now the very dwelling place of God by his Spirit. The point that the temple pointed to Christ, and now the temple is every believer in Christ. That presence that would kill you in the Holy of Holies, that God now loves you and dwells within. He's taken up residence in each one of us because sin has been taken out of the way. Believe the love of God for you. What could be clearer from our text tonight? The love of God for his people. And let that love motivate you. Let our boast be in the Lord that we know him. Let it calm your fears and encourage your heart. Let it empower you and strengthen you to press on in faith and to fight sin and to get our eyes off these lesser things and gaze upon that torn veil. Christ himself and the eternal life that we have by faith in him. J.C. Ryle said, take away the cross of Christ from the Bible and it's a dark, dark book. Thank God that it's not a dark book. Let's pray. Father, thank you for all that we've considered tonight. God, how perfectly and wonderfully you accomplished redemption, and how wonderfully all the glory is yours because of what you have done to magnify your name, to exalt your Son, and we just say thank you for tearing the veil. God, thank you for the glory of what we now have in Christ. And we look forward to the eternity as you continue to unfold to us the grace that you've given to us in Christ. God, may it encourage us today that we know you, and better yet, that you know us in the Son. In Jesus' name, amen.